member.
You're not wrong.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, it's the 4th and 1 podcast brought to you by you guys, the fans, 4th and 1, anchor.fm/4thand1, and of course on Instagram at 4th and 1 podcast. You guys are amazing. Thank you for listening. My camera's way off, so we're going to have a fun time today. Of course, my name is Simeon, and sitting next to me, as always, is Captain Boring Mackay Schlicker, live from Lancaster and Lenox, Pennsylvania. I'll say it one more time. It's the 4th and 1 podcast. Mackay, what's up?
What's up? Comment down below if you could actually hear Simeon talk through those first 30 seconds. I keep trying to tell him to...
Oh my gosh, the music was not loud.
I'm telling you, go when you listen to it, when you listen to it, you will notice that you cannot hear you. That's why I keep telling you to start with the music, fade it out, and then start talking.
No, it's no fun, and it's all just bullshit introduction anyway.
True.
Also, shout out to Carolyn Schlicker.
We're going way over our 15-second time limit for our copyright notice.
First of all, it's 30 seconds. Second of all,
I think it's only 15.
Second of all, it really doesn't matter. YouTube flags it anyway, so I figured if they're going to demonetize us, quote unquote, which we're not monetized, might as well just go with it. Like, it's not like it's illegal. We're not making money off of it and claiming to be. It's not perjury. Sorry, that was Jack Harlow, Lil Nas X, Other Way Around, Industry Baby, which will be a stadium song.
Didn't soon. Even know. Okay, so I didn't know that Jack Harlow was a person.
You don't know who Jack Harlow was a person?
He
has some bops, I'm not going to lie.
I don't know. Is he a rapper? Or?
Yeah, he's a white guy.
Oh, so he's a white wannabe rapper.
No, he's actually good.
Nah.
He's actually good.
The last white rapper that was actually good is still Eminem.
Well, that's just facts. I am 3 days older than he is, actually. He's from Louisville, Kentucky.
Gat.
All right, that was weird. Mackay, they probably can't hear over this anyway. Anyway, we got some breaking news for you guys right before we jumped on here. Tuesday, March 1st, obviously, about, let's say 5:15, Rob Manfred came out, MLB commissioner, and said, owners pay me too much money to let players do whatever we want, so we're canceling some games. I didn't see more details. Mackay, did you have more than that? Will I eat some Doritos?
Just that the MLB sent their quote-unquote best offer to the MLB Players Association, and it was unanimously vetoed by the Players Association, which means that their offer was trash. And so opening day is now canceled, and games will follow, barring any miraculous thing that takes place at the 11th hour.
So is this the end of the MLB?
That's kind of what I'm thinking. Yeah, I mean, they were talking on Get Up this morning. So apparently the players wanting more money. The current deal right now is not very player-friendly at all. And Jeff Passan is siding with the players, and most writers are siding with the players, which is kind of weird in this situation.
Not in today's day and age. It doesn't surprise me.
But... And one of the big things they're fighting over are players staying in the minor leagues too long, because if you stay in the minor, like if a player starts the year in the minor leagues and only plays a certain number of games in the majors, they get an additional contract added onto the rookie year. So if you play like the first 50 games in the minor leagues, then they don't have to, then you get an additional year added onto your rookie contract. So it makes sense for the teams, but the players are very upset about it, rightly so. I think that this is one, probably the downfall, especially with the start of spring football in the USFL, that we need to talk about, that this could be the downfall of the MLB. They were already hurting nationally TV ratings. They're only good regionally. So this might be definitely it definitely starts the slippery slope. Whether the MLB can recover, I don't know. But it definitely starts the slippery slope.
Yikes. I want to stay on this before we jump to the USFL. Right now in the U.S., very, very labor-friendly environment. Plenty of other options immediately that you would
Nursing field? What?
Sorry. That's still, no, that's very label-friendly. How high have salaries risen?
On what? On a scale
over
of zero
the past
to
2 years?
Dog?
on an average, I'm sure they've gone up.
Travel nursing has gone up, but like staff nursing.
You're going to make me look this up.
Staff nursing has not gone up all that much. And the only reason staff nursing is going up is because the hospitals are losing all their staff to go travel. You can get paid roughly 2 to 3 times more to do the same amount of work if you travel right now in terms of nursing than just being a staff.
Just seeing here. That's 2013. salary nurses information is 2018. I would love to be able to see 2020 average nurses salary from 2020-2021. Anyway, I more meant... Oh, there you go. We have that broken down by PA. Average by state. So the median salary for a RN was $75,000 in 2020. In 2018, it was... Where was that? 2018 nurse of $67,000 a year. So in 2019 an RN was 77. So it's gone up more than it's gone up, basically is what I'm saying.
Okay.
I'm not proving you wrong.
Yes, it's gone up every year.
I don't think the nursing shortage has anything to do with payment. I think it has everything to do with administration and expectations on the healthcare field compared to, and yeah, I'll take this into a business podcast, and expectations of medical professionals.
Well, also
the lack of communication between administrators and actual runners of the hospital, people who do shit.
Also, when you have CEOs of hospitals making, you know, $12 million, and then the people getting punched by other people, taking care of the people who punch them, only making $75,000.
Right.
And then you have those same nurses telling the nursing students that, you know, come to shadow or whatever because they're in nursing school, and they tell them, just don't even bother. Like, nursing's a shitty field. And yeah, I've told nursing students that before. Like, why would you... I've literally asked them, why on earth would you pick nursing? I mean, yeah, great career in terms of being able to do a lot of things with it and make a lot of money, or make decent money at least. But, yeah, I mean, you can do so much. Go get another STEM degree and
you don't need a STEM degree.
You make... Yeah, I mean, you go get... Be an excavator.
I'll become a welder.
Yeah, yeah. a welder, a plumber, man. So, anyway, that's not what this podcast is about, but...
But it could be, Makai. You said you wanted to BS more, so I'm just kind of letting
I agree. And yes, I get it. It's very labor-focused right now, kind of the...
All of our sound bites have gone. Oh, what? No. Panic to bring it back. No, that's what I'm saying. You said that CEOs make $9 billion, not actual number, compared to, you know, a fraction of that. We'll say 75% less CEOs are making. It's the same idea. We've had this discussion about owners are the ones who make all the money, and they don't want to pay their players. And this is just kind of what you get when there's a lack of trust, communication, lack of whatever understanding between, hey, like, your product is what you put on the field, and what you're doing right now is saying, yeah, I don't care about what I put on the field. I only care about my bottom line, not understanding at all that your bottom line
is
equals
the
what you put on the field.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
And you don't have a bottom line if you don't put something on the field.
Sure.
And that's the issue
so
that
how,
we get here. Also, is that banana peel still beside you?
No, I did actually clean up the upstairs.
If I had a clapping or cheering because all of our sounds are not working right now, I would play that for you.
Like all of them?
Yeah.
Even though, ba-ding! The Mario coin one?
To play the Mario coin one earlier, and it just didn't play. They'll come back. It's fine. It is what it is.
So how long do you think it'll take? So 2020, the MLB, right, all sport, that was a little bit different. The MLB started that year and then stopped and then resumed kind of late in their bubble.
It was a 60-game or 90-game season?
I don't know. Out in their bubble or whatever. How long do you give Major League Baseball? First of all, let me back up. Do you think they have a season this? Do you
if they have a season, it's
any
half
game?
A season. No, so, we're seeing July at the earliest, I think.
So you think
at this
they?
Point.
I would also agree they start around the All-Star break.
Yeah, I think that's.
And
what
how much do you think that ratings plummet when it comes to World Series? I'm talking like World Series.
Oh, it's not going to be good at all. The issue that you've been having is these owners still think that the fans like baseball. And they do, just not the version that they're putting on the field, and not the version that they're proctoring. It's more of a niche market, and it's not going to be the future like it used to be. I mean, baseball had a great run. You had basically 1950 to 2010, 60 years on top as one of the top-rated sports in the world, at least not America. You're going to have a downfall, and you didn't change with the times. I don't blame the owners here at all. And to be frank, no offense, players, y'all can pivot. So I don't even care about you guys either. Like, the guys who are trying to feed their families, that's on them. No offense. They're not getting screwed over. They're getting screwed over because they're getting screwed over. And listen, I'm fine with what they want. I stand with the players here. But at the same time, I have no sympathy for them if all of a sudden we have a power vacuum because the Major League Baseball is not what it used to be.
All right, so if I may, in terms of ratings, World Series ratings in 2003, I would say that's the height of baseball. 2003 was the heart of the Yankees dynasty, right? Because 2004, then Boston came back in
2003, that was the last World Series that the Yankees won. They had, what, like four in a row, right?
It was like they won in, they had won a lot, but they were dominating the rank Yankees because that was A-Rod and Jeter and all that.
And Jeter and all that.
So the World Series rating was 12.8 with an average World Series of 25 million, right? That was in 2003. 2010, so almost a decade. Well, let's go to a decade later. 2012, it dropped to 7.6 and 12. Mm-hmm. So it basically cut in half. And then last year, 2021, was 6.5 and 11.5. So the average ratings dropped by over half, and the average viewers per million dropped by more than half. And let's take out 2020, because 2020 doesn't count. So in 19, it was 8.1, and then it dropped to 6.5. Like, so how much? So of that 6.5, I'm guessing 4.2.
Yeah, I think
4.2 and 8 million.
I think you cut it in half. I think it's a 3.
I mean that, and that's just not good. And you're not. And as those, and it drops every single year. Well, 2012, it was 7.6, and then 2016, it was 12.9.
Yeah, this is one of those. This is one of
but
those
it's
games
dropped every single year since then.
This is one of those games that the issue that you have is there needs to be a play clock, and that will fix the entire issue because people will fall. It's People fall in love with the beauty of the statistics of the game. The inconsistent consistencies and the consistent inconsistencies that happen in the game. And I fixed your problem. The issue is players don't want it because they want to be able to dance around in the box and on the mound. And they don't realize that they're going to kill themselves. The owners are killing themselves because they don't want to pay the players anything. Because they just want to sell the team when they die. Which they won't even see the money, which is hilarious. So I know I'm harping on the thing over and over and over again. But you're going to see a extreme competitor come up and challenge them for what it is, or you will see soccer take over, which it's on the upswing. On as that kind of number two spot in America, because
number
besides
three.
The NBA,
three.
Number three spot in America, but the NBA is not all, no offense. When LeBron James retires, what happens? Right, the NFL's only there because the NFL's there because Tom Brady right now, and Eli Manning.
The NFL is always going to be there.
They're in number one. I'm not saying they're going to fall, but what I'm saying is, they're poised to keep moving. Okay, the NFL is poised to keep going after their great one retires.
So what happens
in the NBA after LeBron James retires?
It just continues on.
I don't think so.
No, and how do I say this without being? With being woke and racist at the same time, like we all, the NBA is a very progressive league, and a
sure.
very heavy watched African American league. I love the NBA. It's a very heavy watched African American league. So those numbers will always be there. I believe.
I see what you're saying.
There will always be a superstar that people latch onto. John Morant. Last night. Did you see? By the way, did you see that? He had a season full of highlights in one game.
He dropped 41, I think, last night, right?
No, that was the night before. He dropped 52 last night. So, going up. By the way, the MLS, just to get back to your point, they got a little bit to go. For the MLS Cup in 2021, it was 1.1 million viewers.
That was probably one of their highest viewed.
It was. Peaking at 1.6, delivering the fifth most watched audience for an MLS Cup on a Disney-owned network since 1999.
Oh, good for them. Look at Makaya being able to put in the research.
It's what I do, baby!
I watched some soccer this weekend. Unfortunately, Chelsea-Liverpool in, I think, was the FA Cup or the English Cup.
Doesn't matter.
One of the
no
lower
one cares.
Grade cups. Frickin' went to 11. They went to their 12th men. In the penalty shootout. Freaking, you don't go. You start with six. They win another six. Or five, I think, actually,
no
is what it is.
No one cares!
All right, I care because I'm trying to make us diverse. The two white guys podcast.
Yeah, the two white guys podcast. Nice.
As the transitions come and transitions go, this is a transition to the next topic. USFL.
I have a pain.
Yeah, it's called Micaiah. The USFL is suing Fox Sports. The original owners of the USFL. I did that on purpose. Don't worry.
What?
Is suing Fox Sports.
It's very smooth.
Yeah, I read it and I'm like, that's not right. Oh, that's right. It's the original owners. So these are some of the former executives. Now, ladies and gentlemen, this is... We covered this, went 45 minutes bullcrapping last week.
And it was our funniest podcast, and we have that from two reliable sources.
Yes.
Two very reliable. My wife, who doesn't find anything I do funny, she found it funny. And my mother, the number one fan, is back. Ladies and gentlemen, don't worry. Our mother's still alive.
She won't share our podcast. I was thinking about absolutely dragging her through the mud. I won't. She's going through enough.
If you say so. She also said it was funny. So go back, listen to last week's podcast. You listen to the first 45 minutes. It's absolutely gold. It's awesome. We review the uniforms, and then we get all of the
all of the names wrong.
All the names wrong. We give all the names to all the uniforms wrong. Every single one.
Yep. Okay, so The original owners from 1983 to 1985 is suing it, calling the league an unabashed counterfeit. Now, to be fair to these old owners,
it is.
Yeah, they literally reused all the names and most of the color schemes and uniforms.
Yeah,
And some of the logos, even.
I thought that the old owners were on board with it, and that's why they were doing it. So I was very confused. So I'm not sure. I'm sure Fox did its homework, and all the lawyers, I'm sure, will be paid their buku dollars. But speaking of a profession that pays you good money, go be a corporate
lawyer.
Yeah,
well, this is putting a hold on the league.
They're suing to put a hold on the league. Yeah, they're suing to put a hold on the league. There is no hold on the league. They're asking for the league until this lawsuit. But yeah, I mean, like you said, it is, they stole names and color schemes, and
Fox Sports and its partners didn't properly obtain, this is what the suit is saying, alleging, did not properly obtain the league's trademarks and other intellectual properties. Dear Lord, if you want a lawyering 101, go read and or watch the transcripts if that goes to court. Because it's not all fun and games. Trademark law, ladies and gentlemen.
Well, why wouldn't Fox just either pay for the trademark or just rename the teams?
Well, it really, okay, so here's the first,
like, in the beginning,
first, I see what they were trying to do. Oh, why didn't they just, you know, the Fox Sports League, why didn't they call it that, you know, sort of
well,
deal?
Well, no, I'm good with the USFL, fine, whatever.
Why did they reuse the same name?
Yeah.
Branding, marketing.
Right, okay, but then why wouldn't they... They must have a loophole that they figured that they
could
exploit.
Well, here's the thing. Is why would they use it? Either A, the trademarks lapsed, and so they were able to pick them up, and the groups of owners... These are my guess. I'm not a lawyer by any stretch of the imagination. Trademark lapsed.
You are not.
They were able to pick them up, but didn't pick up all of them, let's say.
Okay.
Or B, they did buy them, or didn't buy all of them. And the owners want some of their money back?
Because there were 18 original teams from 80 in the... And now we're only at 8. So, yeah.
But you could call them the, you know, the Michigan Timbuktuers and put them out there in tutus, and that would be fine. It's football.
Yeah, no, and they will have more ratings than
also, I would rate Michigan tutus as a mascot. 3, 2, 1, 4. 5.
Oh.
That was out of 10, right?
That was out of 10. Sure. Yeah, yeah. Sure.
Michigan tutus. That was pretty
six. Off of the top of your head. I'll give it like a 4.
It reminds me of one of those backyard football kind of.
Yes. With the greatest athlete of all time. What was his name? Pablo Sanchez.
Pablo Sanchez.
Yes.
Pablo the man Sanchez.
You guys
want to know where our love of Mexicans come from? It comes from Pablo Sanchez.
Again, woke and racist at the same time, people.
who put... This sounds really racist.
Okay.
But who put the Mexican as the best player? Like, do you know how many black kids there were on those games?
Yeah.
How come there wasn't some yoked, you know, 5'3" sixth grader that was just...
Sixth grader.
I don't know. Whatever. I don't know how old they were. They were like 12.
I don't know the age range. Yeah, I don't know if they were just trying to get that demographic into the game or what. But he was a cheat code, man.
At every game. They never nerfed him.
Yeah.
Baseball, soccer, football.
Basketball. Do you remember basketball?
Dude had an arm. Yeah. Dude had speed.
Wheels. I think the worst thing he was most known for is his wheels.
What was his name? It wasn't Ahmed. It was something. There were the two brothers, and the one always had the headphones on.
Yes. Uh-huh. I know who you're talking about.
They were two Arabian dudes. I think that's the PC term to use. That guy had wheels. The older brother was the runner.
And then there was that... What was the kid in the wheelchair's name? Gordon? Or
Kenny.
Something? Kenny.
Kenny Kawaguchi.
He could pitch. He did like a little flip when he would pitch in his wheelchair, man. He could pitch in backyard baseball. He was awesome.
I'm looking at Kenny Kawaguchi, Backyard Sports.
He definitely had, they definitely gave him more speed than I believe than someone in, and, I mean, I don't know, but.
In a wheelchair?
Yeah, in a wheelchair should have. I mean, he had one of those sports wheelchairs, but again, he was like on pace with like Pablo.
Oh, I forgot they made backyard hockey too.
Backyard hockey was, Kenny was getting around on the ice in his wheelchair, man.
Yep, remember that.
You got that for Christmas one year. It was the same Christmas I got my Razor scooter.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. And so you were playing backyard hockey, and I was going around the house. Dad was pretty mad because I was riding my scooter in the house.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, here is our first rabbit hole. We are going down memory lane. Unfortunately, I will say this, unfortunately, they did do a horrible job at remaking the games in later. So, in this case, this is Vicky Kawaguchi.
That's Kenny's sister, yeah.
Kenny's sister, and that's her 2010 version.
Oh.
Yeah. They 2021'd her in
2010.
Yeah, it was bad. She was very fast. Also a good pitcher. Good fielding.
She sucked at hitting, though.
Okay, hold on. Pete Wheeler. That's Wheels. Let's see here. Okay, Kenny Kawaguchi, nickname K-Man. Okay.
Dude. He could pitch. Oh, Harry Potter. No one cares about your Harry Potter return to Hogwarts.
So, yeah, he could pitch, run. That was baseball 97. That was the OG.
See, look at that. I mean, his wheels are three.
Yeah, look running three. And he could... He must have been a... Like, his forearms must have been yoked.
Oh, his forearms were totally yoked.
So that was the original. 97 was the original. Then they came back in 01 and 03, I'm seeing. We didn't play these ones.
No, we just played 97. And then they came
back in 05. Soccer in 98, that was the one we played.
Wheels are three in that game. It's three out of four, by the way, which is kind of weird. All the games are three are like... And then, I mean,
Kicking out of three. He was three out of three in catching, running, and kicking.
Dude, this guy is a superstar in football. And then,
He's better in football 2002.
Yeah. Dude is
He was a goalkeeper. That makes sense. Goalkeeper
yes,
in...
He was, which sort of makes sense, yeah.
So here's the GOAT. Mr. Sanchez himself. Sorry for all the ads.
The only guy who could beat Michael Jordan at his own game.
Probably. So,
how big is that dude's head?
Ginormous. Secret Weapon was his nickname.
Yeah.
Which is a great nickname. Wait, there's a present? Present. Pablo's hat is now red, and he's gotten a brown tan. That's racist.
Yeah. So, look at that. He's four out of four in batting, running. Pitching, he's only three out of four. So Kenny's got a leg up on him. And fielding, he's four out of four. Also, where did you find this website?
This is backyardsports.fandom.com.
Oh, so someone committed their life's work to breaking down the backyard sports characters. Kenny's actually a better football player than Pablo is. Look at that.
Oh, yeah, this is his backyard. That's his football. Where's his, hold on. There's hockey, basketball. He was Steph Curry. He was barely Steph.
Well, they only gave him a one on an inside shot. Yeah. Wow, that's terrible.
He was a pure shooter. This is what I love, trivia. Pablo Sanchez doesn't speak English, or so it seems. Pablo does actually have lines that reveal he speaks near-perfect English, mentioning he learned Spanish while in school. This was a joke by the developers because they couldn't find a native Spanish speaker to voice him, as Dex Manley only learned a bit of Spanish in high school.
Wow.
Oh, my gosh.
Well, fun facts you learn about, but he is the GOAT, man. He could take anyone. Oh, yes, Pete Wheeler, the fastest
AKA
guy.
Wheelie.
The fastest guy in all. I mean, he could outrace Pablo.
Yeah. And he had a four in the original.
He was solid, man. He was a dork, though.
Total dork.
I mean,
he's a lefty too. I just realized
he's a southpaw. I mean, look at that. His tongue's hanging out the side of his face. You know who he kind of reminds me of? He kind of reminds me of like a golden retriever if it were a person in a video game.
That is a great representation of who Pablo is.
How much D&D do you play that you're getting ads for D&D?
Well, no, Fandom is a big D&D like website, so like it is what it is. These are the people who bought like Honest Trailers. I was hoping that I could find the roster on... Oh, wait. This isn't... We still need to scroll down. Oh, no. Hold on. I was hoping I could find, like, the actual roster of players. Ah, list of backyard sports characters.
There you go. There you go.
Oh, yes. Good old Sunny Day was the main commentator throughout the sports. And she would bring in different, like, Vincent Vinny the Gooch... who commentated
Earl
backyard
Gray
baseball?
Was soccer.
Earl Gray was soccer. Barry DJ was a basketball game. That's right.
Just real quick, how old were you when you realized that Sunny Day was like was a pun? Because I was
not
too
until
old.
I recently rewatched. There was a guy who was playing all the backyard games.
Uh huh. Sure.
And yeah, not like Chuck Downfield.
Yeah, I mean, I was far too old until I knew that. Yeah.
Stephanie Morgan. She was solid. Dante Robinson.
Dante Robinson. Was he the dude with the fro?
Yeah, that was the dude with the fro. Keisha Phillips. She was a good power hitter. Yeah, rocket for an arm there. We obviously had Vinny and Vicky Kawaguchi, Ashley Weber and Sydney Weber. They were blonde twins who fit the stereotype.
Yep.
Dmitry Petrovich, total nerd.
Ernie Steele.
You remember Ernie?
What did it say there? The tallest of the backyard kids?
Backyard kids, yeah.
He was... There was something funny about Ernie. He was...
His
little hat. Yes, yes, and he ran very, very.
Yeah,
because
he was tall
awkwardly.
And lengthy. You put him at third base. You know, he was at third base.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Reese Worthington, Mikey Thomas. I'm trying to remember these. Oh yeah, Tony Delvecchio, who Angela or Angie was the better. Tony's younger sister was the better player. Even though she was quiet, is what I'm remembering.
Yeah,
in baseball, they were stereotypical.
She's not Italian.
People.
Yeah, Billie Jean Blackwood, a tall Southern girl who speaks with a Southern accent. I don't remember.
You have to pull up the
Billie Jean. Yes.
Yeah, you have to pull. You have to pull up. I don't even remember some of these people. I like don't remember until I see them. Yes,
yeah,
MVP, great at everything. Okay,
except
never mind.
She's not. She's good at batting and fielding, and that's it.
Marky, Du Bois, and Sally. Oh, Sally Dobbs.
Oh, there's your Ahmed
Khan and Amir Khan.
Yes. And one had headphones and was the little brother who was better than the older brother, right?
I think we're going to look. So Amir was the younger brother, nicknamed Sticks.
He was
3-2-3, yep. And then Ahmed was the one who had
the
headphones.
See, I related most to Ahmed because I thought was Ahmed.
Not to be weird, you kind of were growing up.
Mm-hmm.
Same kind of head shape, always had headphones on.
That's a little hurtful.
You know, it is what it is, but we're getting back now. So basically, look out for Micaiah and Simeon play series, where we will be playing and commentating NCAA 2007, as well as all the backyard sports, most likely.
Oh, is that what we're doing now? And we have a platform that we can play all these on. I mean, your PC's pretty good, right?
Yeah. We could totally make it work, and we would have a ton of fun doing it.
Oh, we totally would.
We would totally have to play GeoGuessr, and by we, I would have to watch you absolutely fail at GeoGuessr.
What's GeoGuessr?
You don't... Okay, so this
exactly.
is...
Exactly, and that's where you go exactly and move on.
You're not wrong. Did I get these back?
Yes, you did. They
work
again.
We have them back.
Ladies and gentlemen, the sound bites work again.
We don't actually have that sound bite.
Oh.
Micaiah, Sean McVay, you told me this on Saturday. He is staying put.
Wants to run it back.
Oh. I heard wants a running back, which he does probably.
Oh, probably.
But
yep.
He is staying put as the head coach of the Los Angeles Rams after losing yet another offensive coordinator for like the third year straight. So what does it say for the NFL? What does this say for the Los Angeles Rams? And then that's all the questions I have because, to be frank, don't really care about this.
Okay, well, again, this wasn't really the point of me putting this on the dock, my brother. It was what's underneath this that's
then why,
important.
But that's invented. That's
well,
invented.
Well, because I need my sports talk, because if I don't get my sports talk fix, I will jones to the point where I'm itching at my open my scabs and yelling at people and freaking out. So what it says for Sean the NFL is he's a great coach, a great offensive mind, and so they keep one of those. What it says for the Rams is as long as he and Matthew Stafford are there, their offense is going to be great, but they got to figure out the salary cap. Great move for the Rams.
And let me say this. This is where Micaiah wanted to go because that's how much I care and we spent so much time on backyard sports. Micaiah was thinking he would go into commentating, which so did I. Possible new commentator combos is the note Micaiah has. And he has this because our guy, Troy the Flake, the Aikman, I don't know, I just came up with that.
No, that would be his backyard baseball name.
That
Troy
would be.
The Flake Aikman.
Yeah, Troy the Flakeman.
Nice.
He just went to Monday Night Football to commentate alongside somebody.
No one knows.
17.5 million?
Yeah, something like
over
that.
Over so many years? I don't know.
Well,
was that a year?
Who was it? Romo set the new standard at 18 a year with CBS. And so CBS has their tandem in Jim Nantz and Tony Romo.
Yeah.
They'll do football there. So Monday Night Football's ratings have been hurting for quite a while.
Yeah.
Ever since John Gruden left to be the Raiders head coach and then was subsequently fired. So, so good. So, Monday Night Football play-by-play and color commentators have been hurting, so they went and signed Troy Aikman. Here's the problem. Joe Buck, who Troy Aikman was paired with over at Fox, he only has 1 year left on his deal. He's getting paid $11 million to be the head guy for the NFL on Fox and the MLB on Fox. Well, I'm sure Fox is looking at the MLB and like, well, you don't need that. So the reports are they're going to let ESPN talk and Joe talk. So we might have Joe Buck and Troy Aikman at ESPN. Here's the other caveat. Al Michaels left Sunday Night Football. Mike Tirico is taking over there with Chris Collinsworth and Drew Brees. Al Michaels is now on Thursday night with Amazon Prime. So McVay actually turned down a over $100 million contract to go do Thursday night football with Amazon Prime to stay with the Rams, which is he's making way less money with the Rams, which tells you this is more about football than it is the money, which is kind of what you want in your head football coach. So who does Al Michaels get paired with? If Joe Buck stays, who do they pair with him? A lot of people think it's Greg Olsen. If Joe Buck leaves for ESPN, who does Fox take over as the number one in the number one booth? Listen, I'm a geek. I love commentators. Most of the time when I'm choosing what college football game to watch, besides the matchup, if they're equally interesting matchups, I will go with who's better to listen to. And so I kind of like this stuff. But Al Michaels is kind of... I think a lot of people thought that it would be Al Michaels and Sean McVay doing Thursday night. But now that Amazon got turned down, they made a run at Aikman, couldn't get him. They made a run at McVay and couldn't get them. So now, I don't even know who's rumored now for that. But the next...
We are. So we're like to announce that... No. But guys, we're just saying we're open. You haven't necessarily seen us in commentating. Peyton Manning and Eli Manning. Hello. Peyton Manning would be the next they're making.
Well, also, does someone make a run at Tom Brady?
Yep. Tom Brady would be another big name. Other names that, you know, may want to pop in. I'm sure Pat McAfee would be another name that would probably
get thrown out
there.
Fox can't do anything until Joe Buck's decided.
Sure. The Greenbergs would also be another good pick. Now that they're out of the game, Mike Greenberg and or his son, or both of them combined, one of them doing play-by-play, the other doing color.
You mean
not
the Greenbergs?
The Golics, yeah. I'm sorry. They both had G's. That's just the names off the top of my head that I think would be a good pickup. So basically we have to figure out who's going to be what, how much money Fox wants to spend. I don't think any of their college guys would necessarily want to move. I know I just named all males, so don't forget there are some females who want to move. While Doris Burke sometimes annoys me, she's also one of the best NBA commentators out there.
She's so amazing. Yeah.
No offense, but the NBA kind of proved that girls know what's up too. That makes me sound sexist, but just stick with me, guys.
Another big name is Kurt Herbstreit and Chris Fowler. So
right. So I was wondering about that. You think they would move to the big time?
No,
it's not the big time.
So I could see Chris Fowler moving to Monday Night Football with Aikman. I don't think Herbstreit loves college football too much. Herbstreit is like me. His love of college football, he loves calling pro football games, but he loves college football too much to not be on game day and not do Saturday night football every week. So I don't think Herbstreit will move. There's a chance that Fowler could move, although I really like Fowler. I really think Fowler likes working with Herbstreit and doing college football as well. There are a lot of good names, and we should keep it. I think for Fox, if Buck were to leave, they would just promote whoever their second team is. It's Greg Olson, whoever Greg Olson is paired with on their second team, and move them to
probably
Joe Davis, I believe his name is, and he's got a nice voice as well.
So enough on the commentators. Well, I got an attention span of a gnat today. Sorry,
a gnat.
A gnat. It happened.
The G is silent.
And to be fair, so me and Makai love the Sandlot. Well, at least I do. So much that I love PF Flyers. He's probably doing some research, so I'm just going to talk over him. So, Makai is normally saying, "You're killing me, Smalls," to me, but he doesn't say it to me. He'll either look at me in a way, or he'll just put off the vibe that's just like...
So, you got Kevin... It's Kevin Burkhart, and... Kevin Burkhart is paired with Greg Olson, and they're the second team for Fox. So it is assumed that they would just bump to the first team. Joe Davis.
You're a Duke, man.
Fox Sports unveils new... Joe Davis is...
He's a man.
Yeah.
His last name's Davis. His first name's Joseph, probably.
Yeah. You don't know. It could be Josephine.
It could be Jose.
It could be Joe Mama.
Could be his middle name could be Mama, and his first name could be Joe.
Youths. It could be Adam Amin and Mark Schlereth could go
that's
there.
That's a good one. That's a good one. And there's a bunch of other no names that we don't know.
Yeah.
Right?
So yeah, I'm good with it. I'm good with it. Gus Johnson could also move up, could go from Big Noon Saturday.
Thank you. Yes, that's who I was thinking of. Speaking of Big Noon Saturday and the NCAA, whoa, look at this transition. The NCAA has relaxed their marijuana testing thresholds.
Yeah,
Question
like,
mark?
Did I not talk about this last week? I feel
you
like
I have. This is brand new to me.
Okay, great.
So teach me. Learn me something.
Yeah, so the NCAA has relaxed some of the... Not that the NCAA has any power, but it relaxed some of... It relaxed the threshold for THC in the system. So so what it did was, I don't know if it would have had to hire it. So that means that you can, these players can be smoking some amount of pot and not pot positive. And it also relaxed some of the suspension guidelines associated with offenders who violate this. So again, this kind of just goes back to the start of the podcast when we say things are more in favor of labor now than they ever have been, and I think that goes to prove. We can get into a big argument, and if you want to do it now, that's fine. We're 45 minutes into the podcast, but I don't think smoking pot should be a suspendable offense at all.
Well,
the NBA doesn't even test for it anymore.
Right? Yeah. This goes back,
and neither does the NFL.
Thank you. This goes back to the old, good old war on drugs. And we can get into that if you want to, but that's
the
not
drugs
what we're here.
Won the war on drugs.
Yeah, basically. Okay, so we're in agreement there. So this is all it goes back to, and what we're starting to see is a slow dismemberment in society of our understanding on the war on drugs. Now, we've had a few road bumps along the way and things that have distracted us, cough, cough, Russia. So I don't think we're going to get there anytime soon, but you're not wrong. And so what we'll end up seeing, I feel like, is we'll see these players go from student athletes to brand ambassadors of these schools as we start to move away from a reliance on education and higher education to a reliance more on living life and figuring stuff out. It's not like these big brands like Michigan, like Alabama, Georgia, Texas A&M are going to go anywhere. People are still going to want to go get an education. People are still going to want to go get to school. And specifically, we're still going to need some semblance of a preparatory football program before people get to the NFL. And the best place to do that is through your local school who's been doing it and who has everything. So I don't see this as a bad thing. I see this as a move in the right direction, and I see even more relaxation as more money comes in from the NIL deals, as we see whatever regulation looks like or lack of regulation looks like over NIL. And we'll move away more from strict, maybe non-marijuana use, maybe a little more less PED use, that sort of stuff, where as we move to more of a professional format that the NCAA needs to bring in and kind of has to bring in and is being forced to bring in.
Yeah. But also, I think guys actually... You might laugh, but guys like Snoop Dogg, who are caught on television taking a hit of a blunt right before they go on the halftime show, guys like that who prove that you can be wildly successful and smoke pot have really helped the relaxing of the rules. And let's not forget that the war on drugs was only started because a guy who owned trees wanted hemp outlawed to get rid of his competition. So he ran an ad campaign saying that marijuana is this is the most evil of all evil drugs, is on the same, by the FDA, classified as a Schedule 1 drug, which is, or Schedule 5, I don't know, whichever one's the worst,
Schedule
is
1.
The same as heroin, right? There is no medical use for it. It is classified as that, or was at one point, and got it classified just because he wanted all the money for his paper. And paper products.
I'm making paper. Look at me now. Speaking of, we're just kind of cruising along here today, guys. Listen, I have to go cook for my wife.
I got a poop.
Makai's got a poop. Speaking of Russia, Yeah.
UEFA. UEFA.
UEFA? Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
I was my mind. And FIFA, Football yeah. International Federal Association. I don't know. It's French. I don't care. Removed Russia teams from all competition. Originally, Sweden and a couple other countries had said, nope. And then FIFA came out and said, okay, you guys can play, but only on neutral sites, so no playing in Russia or basically in the away team's home. So they came out yesterday, I believe, and said, nope, okay, we're done. This is after talks broke down, unfortunately, last night with between Ukraine and Russia.
And UEFA, the Champions League finals no longer in East Petersburg as well. So
St. Petersburg.
Whatever. East Petersburg, St. Petersburg. It's the same thing.
No, they are very far apart.
Nope. Same thing. One, they're both 20 minutes down the road from me. So if you don't know about what's going on between Russia and Ukraine, that's not the podcast. This is not the podcast to fill you in on. So go look that up.
I actually have a coworker whose family is in Kyiv.
Okay. And well, that's a scary situation.
Yeah.
For them.
He's like freaking the F out.
I'm sure he is, he should.
Yeah. He's luckily unable to contact them. But I just want to make that very clear. Guys, literally, that's one degree of separation between me and this conflict.
T's
for
and
anybody.
P's. T's and P's.
Yeah. Yeah. So, shut up.
What?
I was trying to make it real and be honest and try to bring some drama to our podcast.
Well, you know, that's
like,
not... Well,
I have to go poop. Then go freaking poop. I'll tell them what to bet on this week.
T's and P's. T's and P's.
Well, Dimitri, I love you.
What do you think? What do you think about that?
About UEFA and FIFA?
Yeah, because...
I love it.
But they're also punishing players who might not be Russian.
It's their... No, they would have to be Russian.
Why? There's a Russian team playing in the Europa League. There's a Russian team, but not all players on that team is Russia.
Okay, well that's not their fault. And honestly, the point of this is nobody agrees with what Russia's doing.
Yes, obviously no one agrees with what Russia's doing except Russia.
And well, yeah, even some of Russia doesn't agree with what Russia's doing.
Yeah, but
so you want to put as the most amount of world pressure on them as you can.
Yeah.
And guess what? Some guys from America, Canada, frickin' Argentina, and Sweden are not going to be able to play soccer for a year, okay? They'll end up, they're great soccer players. They're going to go play somewhere else and make money playing soccer and doing what they love in probably a much better environment than Russia. No offense.
Like, so,
listen, I'd rather play in Africa than play in Russia.
So I am glad that FIFA and UEFA did this, but also it's like, okay, like, no one. In terms of, if you're looking at it from Russia's point of view, right, the higher-ups at Russia, they're like, we don't care. Whatever. This is just a casualty of the times.
War. Yep. Yeah. Well, maybe it is, maybe it isn't. Maybe it puts more pressure on the Russian people, and it puts pressure on, therefore, the higher-ups in Russia, more pressure on the military to change their mind and kind of go against Vladimir Putin.
I really do hope so, but unfortunately...
I don't think this is going to be the straw that broke the camel's back.
Imagine if
Putin's
they
like,
came
oh,
out...
frick, and, I really liked them. All right,
and
well,
came
that's
out and
it.
Said, well, due to... I just really needed our soccer team to play, and I needed the Champions League
finals. We were really looking forward to that money in St. Petersburg. We really needed it, guys.
In East Petersburg,
oh my
I really
gosh.
Needed it. I really needed it. So, yeah, we're going to pull out.
Is this why you hate sports?
No.
When sports get political, is this why you hate sports?
Sometimes. Not in this case. In this case, it was the right thing to do, and I agree with it. I was just playing devil's advocate, asking you. But yes, when sports do cross over...
I know you
were.
I was moving on.
No, when it's a fair question. When sports do cross over into politics, I do have a problem with that. Because a lot of people view sports as their getaway from the real world.
Yeah.
And... whether
Chelsea's owner actually gave up, he put his ownership in his stewardship so that he would be away from the situation, which I thought was wise.
Is he Russian?
Smart of him.
Or
he is Russian.
Oh, I see. Yeah. So yeah.
Fans are calling for him to have to sell the team, which is just, guys, okay.
That's why I hate when that sports. Yeah, right there. That's the reason why I hate when sports cross over into politics, because of that reason right there. I don't know if this guy's ever done anything devilish as invading Ukraine, but I highly doubt it if he owns a soccer team. I really highly doubt it. I mean, maybe, but I doubt it.
I look like I have a hunchback right now. And for those of you who are watching on YouTube. So, I hate sports this week because... Well, honestly, because owners are dumb.
Because who are dumb?
Owners. I know I've been harping on this. The thing is, like, my third or fourth week that owners are dumb. But they just kind of screw everything up. See baseball. And that's all I'm going to say about it. I will eventually come up with something else that I hate about sports. I love hockey, by the way. Getting really back into hockey for some odd reason. I'm going to not watch any more of it. I probably watched the most hockey I watched when... with you, but we did watch hockey. What game was that? What game did we end up watching?
It was Pittsburgh and the Rangers.
Yes, good game. Good game all around. Don't know who won it.
You want to know what I'm betting on?
I am betting on hockey this week, so I do want to know what you're betting on.
I got a spicy little +700 parlay.
Oh, I got +842.
Okay, so this is going to drop. Okay, so this is going to drop after these games take into effect. So so this is March 1st today, time of this recording. So go back, look at the stats for March 1st, and I'll try to post it on Instagram whether both of ours hit or not.
Okay.
And if you like it, people, DM the pod at 4th and 1 podcast. And let us know you're looking for a parlay, and we'll give you some parlay action.
Gambling problem? Call 1-800-GAMBLER.
Absolutely. So I got a 4-leg parlay. Sadiq.
You just go off of what's on top, don't you?
No.
Continue.
No.
Go ahead.
Sadiq Bey over 16.5 points.
Okay.
Trey Young to record 8+ assists. Seth Curry under 4.5 assists, and Carl Anthony Towns, the 3-point champion, over 1.5 made threes. So he needs to make two. Which one am I most nervous about? Sadiq Bey over 16.5 points.
Well, this is interesting because he's set to the one that's on top, which I think I'm going to put a small little bet on just for kicks and giggles. So, like, the bet of the week, the bet of the week, the hot bet that everybody's making right now, they put that on top, has him at 3.3 plus, so over 3 made threes.
Carl Anthony Towns?
No, Sadiq Bey.
Mm. Well, he's been really hot of late. The Seth Curry under 4.9, listen, ever since...
That's the one, I know that he's working with Kyrie now. So he doesn't have to run point, but that's the one that...
So here are his stats from his last 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7,
also, didn't
8,
know they played
9,
a Duke
10.
Together.
10 games. Here are his assist stats for the last 10 games. 3, 3, 1, 4, 6, 5. That was all. He played 30-plus minutes with that, and he was in Philadelphia for some of those. Then 0... 2, 4, 3. So again, it only hurts me if he goes 5 or over, and he's only done that twice in the last 10 games. So I'm feeling pretty spicy about it.
So this is mine. It's a 3-leg parlay. It's a 3-game parlay. All. I'm having the Edmonton Oilers -1.5.
Okay.
The Colorado Avalanche -1.5, and the Vegas Golden Knights -1.5.
Total score?
Points, yeah. Goals, whatever they want to call
it. Wait, under -1.5?
No. I'm picking the over-under. What is that called? Like when it's the Tampa Bay Buccaneers +7.5?
So minus would be their.
So they have to win by two goals.
Correct.
Okay. So I like the Avs one. The Avs can score a lot. I don't know anything about hockey, so I don't know whether these are good.
I don't
or not.
Either. I also, to be honest, I thought this bet, and this is probably what I'm going to end up going to make, I thought that was the money line, forgetting that that's not how
did,
the money line
did you
works.
Win your golf bet?
I did not win either of my golf
I have
bets.
Not, I have not won a what are you betting on segment yet, and I bet on James Harden, his first two games in Philadelphia.
Okay.
And each one was a four-leg parlay, and I missed it.
Ooh.
Just by one on each single one. On the last one, I had Joel Embiid plus 3.5 assists over, hit the over, and he had three.
Hold on.
Two at the end of the first quarter.
I'm going to give you, I need to get this over 300. There we go. Okay, I'm going to give you five winners from tonight's NHL games, okay?
Okay.
This is my real bet, okay? These are all money line bets.
Yep, okay.
Edmonton Oilers,
yep.
Tampa Bay Lightning, Colorado Avalanche, Vegas Golden Knights, Boston Bruins.
Nice. I love
it. I love that. That's a plus 473, so.
By the way, James
gambling
Harden.
Problem, call one
James Harden
gambling.
And.
Oh, you're going to talk about it?
Well, just comment on it. James Harden and Joel Embiid look good. And Ben
they look very good.
So, everyone. All
I saw was statistics.
I saw. On NBA Countdown or whatever was on the television as I was leaving work, they're like, the Nets can't be ruled out because Ben Simmons is a legitimate blah, 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 blah. Ben Simmons still cannot shoot jump shot.
What?
Can people stop falling in love with him?
What does he have in the closet?
What kind of what?
I have no one... When statistics are so far against a player, I have seen no one, a mass group of people, love him. He wasn't that good in high college.
So what they're banking on is that he has produced the since he came into the league, he has produced the most wide open threes of any player. That's nice. But where did that get Philadelphia?
But he's still not doubling his assists. See, we need to double his assists for that to be productive.
He still needs to be able to shoot or at least attempt a three-pointer. Philadelphia would not have gotten rid of him if he was at least shooting three-pointers. Not making, just shooting, and he won't. And you can try, and you can say he's an all-NBA defender, that's fine. Kyrie Irving, for what Ben Simmons is good at in defense, Kyrie Irving is lax and then some in that. And Kyrie Irving can only play half the games. So you're still out there with a center and Simmons. Both can't shoot outside the paint. Then you got Durant and Curry and whoever else they put at the three. So, whatever. You guys can take the Nets as the betting favorites. I will take literally anybody else.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, let's see if I pick the right sound. Oh, it stopped working again.
And they don't work again. Wow, Riverside, get your ish together,
Get your ish together,
hey,
Riverside.
I don't think we swore in this podcast, so does that mean that Mom might share this one?
No, I swore it right at the beginning.
Ah, but was the music covering it up because it was too loud?
No, it was after. Oh my god. Well, fuck you, first of all.
Hey, there we go. Sorry, ma'am. Sorry, ma'am.
So anyway, insert music here. That's the 4th and 1 podcast. We're gonna wrap it up and let you guys go live your life now that we've brought joy to it, because that's what we are. We're the joyous podcast. On the interweb. My name, of course, is Micaiah. His name is Simeon.
Wow. Yep. Yeah. Just keep rolling with it.
Yep. This has been 4th and 1. Support us, anchor.fm/4th and 1. Instagram, 4th and 1 podcast. Micaiah, hit it with
it. Wash your hands, you filthy animals. God bless. And peace out.
We love
out.
You. Bye.
Bye.
You have poison in your mind, and the fact that you can't see it makes me so.